Welcome back. In this video, I will discuss plant leaf disease prediction project using CNN. The main aim of this project is to create convolutional neural network, that is CNN, which will predict whether a plant is suffering from a disease or not. CNN classification model is trained, validated, and tested with a different number of layers and other hyperparameters. CNN network is built using TensorFlow and Keras in this case. The main motivation behind selecting this particular project is there is a need to increase food production by an estimate of 70% by 2050 to feed an expected population size that is predicted to be over 9 billion people. Currently, infectious disease reduces the potential yield by an average of 40%. Many farmers in developing world experiencing yield losses as high as 100%. So there is a need to develop a system which will predict the disease at the earlier stage. To implement plant leaf disease prediction project, we need to follow the following steps. The first step is to mount the Google Drive on Google Colab and then import the dataset. So in this case, I want to implement the project on Google Colab. Hence, I need to place all my datasets on Google Drive and then I need to import from there onwards. If you are using a standalone machine, then this particular step is not required. The second step is to import all the required libraries. Next, we need to visualize the images and then we need to resize those particular images. That is, once you import the dataset, next we need to visualize the images, whether they have been imported correctly or not. If required, we need to resize those particular images. Next, we need to convert those particular images into NumPy array because we cannot give image as an input to the CNN model. So we will convert those particular images into NumPy array and then we will normalize them into 0 to 255 in this case. Next, we need to visualize the class count and check for the class imbalance. If there is a class imbalance, then we need to address that particular issue, otherwise the model may overfit in this case. The sixth step is to split the dataset into train, validate, and then the test sets. Next, we need to perform one-hot encoding on the target variable. In this case, we have assigned 0, 1, 2 are the labels for this particular target. If you assign these values, the 2 will override or you can say that outperform 0 and 1. So to avoid that particular thing, we need to perform something called as one-hot encoding, where we will give equal importance to each of those particular target variables. Eighth step is to create the model architecture, compile the model, and then we need to fit this particular model using the training data. This is one of the very important steps of this particular project. Once you train your model, then we need to plot the accuracy and loss against each epoch. Then we will make the predictions on the testing data. And then we will visualize whether the predictions are correct or not on this particular testing data. If you feel everything is correct and the expected accuracy has been reached, then you can deploy that particular project using the Streamlit application over here. Now we will discuss the implementation of each of these particular 12 steps one by one. The first step is to import the data sets from the Google Drive. So first we need to mount the Google Drive into Google Colab. For that reason, first we will import a drive from google.colab and then we will use the mount function from this particular drive and then we will mount that Google Drive into Google Colab. So once you run this particular cell, it will ask you to connect to this particular Google Drive. So you click on this particular button called connect to Google Drive. So once you click on this button, it will ask you to select the account where your data set is stored. So select that particular account. And then you need to click on this particular allow button. So once you click on this particular allow button, the Google Drive will be mounted in your Google Colab. So once it is mounted, you can import the data set from the Google Drive over here. Now to visualize whether it is mounted successfully or not, or our files are visible or not, I will use this ls command in this case. So ls, this content slash drive is the place where we have mounted that particular Google Drive. Within that, I have created a folder called as My Drive. Within that, I have created another folder called as Projects. Within that, there is another folder called as Plant Leaf Disease Prediction over here. Now once I run this particular ls command, I will be able to see different folders here. So the first folder is the dataset, second folder is the application, third folder is model, and the fifth one is our actual code in this particular case, that is ipynb in this case. So I will show that particular thing over here. You can see the three folders are there, and then this is the code, actual code you can see. So once you run this particular complete code, the model will be saved into this particular folder called as model, and this particular dataset contains your entire dataset, and this is the Streamlit application over here. Now we will try to visualize the content of this particular dataset. So again, I will run this particular ls command. I will append this particular dataset to this particular path. So you can notice here there are three folders are there. The first folder is corn common rust, second one is potato early blight, third one is tomato bacterial spot over here. So we will try to see whether we have those particular folders here. Yes, we have the same folders in our Google Drive in this case. With this, we were able to mount the Google Drive in our Google Colab, as well as we were able to visualize the content of that particular the Google Drive over here. Now we will import the required libraries. There were a lot of libraries are required for implementing this particular project. So I will import all those particular libraries over here. There are basic libraries like NumPy, Pandas, and Matplotlib. There are some specific libraries like CV2, that is for image processing. Then we need to import the libraries from what you can say that Keras and TensorFlow. So I will import all those particular libraries over here. So once you import your libraries, one very important thing you need to notice is make sure that the TensorFlow version is 2.12.0 here. If you are using any other TensorFlow, make sure that the project will work perfectly fine. If it gives some errors, you can install this particular TensorFlow version, because this particular project is implemented using 2.12.0. So definitely it will work on this particular version. If you are installing any newer version or older version, some of these particular libraries may or may not work over there. Now we will go with the third step, where we will visualize the images, whether they are imported successfully or not, as well as we will try to resize those particular images if required. So here I have used the matplotlib, and then I have drawn 12 images randomly. On x-axis I have mentioned the size of horizontal number of pixels. On y-axis I have mentioned vertical number of pixels over here. Now if you look at this particular image, you can see here I have displayed few of those particular images, actually 12 images. The horizontal and vertical number of pixels are 256 by 256 here. Everywhere we have the same thing. The meaning of this one is the resizing is not required over here. Now we will convert those particular images into NumPy array, because we cannot give image as an input to our CNN model. And then we will normalize them into 0 to 255 over here. For that reason, I have defined a function called as convert underscore image underscore to underscore array. It will take one image at a time, and then that particular image will be read with the help of OpenCV function. And then if that particular image is present, then it will be converted into something called as the array here. That's a NumPy array, and that will be returned to you. So this is the functionality of this particular function over here. If that particular image is not present, it will return you. You can say that empty NumPy array over here. Now we need to call this particular function. For that reason, I have written this particular cell here. Now I have set this particular dir to our dataset path till dataset, and then these are the three labels: tomato bacterial spot, potato early blight, and corn common rust over here. Basically, I have assigned the label as 012 for each of these particular thing. Now what we need to do is from each of these particular directories, we need to read the images. So within this dataset, we have three directories. So from one directory, we need to read one image, all the images you can say, one after the other. Similarly, we have to do it for the remaining directories. So once you get that particular complete path, we will pass that particular complete path as an input to this particular function, what we have created in the earlier cell. And then we will get that particular array form of image over here that will be stored into image list here. So image list contains the array, NumPy array of each and every images over here. And then we will assign the label for that particular thing. So in the first directory, the label will be 0. For the second one, it will be 1. For the third directory, the label will be 2 in this particular case. So image list contains all the images, labels list contain all the labels for those particular images over here. Now coming back to the next step, we need to check whether the data set is balanced one or imbalanced one. For that reason, first we will see the class count. In this case, you can see here the 0th class we have 300 images, first class we have 300 images, to second class we have 300 images. The meaning of this one is for each of those particular classes we have equal number of the images over here. It shows that there is no imbalance in this particular case. If we have imbalanced data set, we need to address that particular issue immediately. Otherwise, there is a possibility that the model will go into overfitting situation. Now I will see the shape of this particular images. So if you look at this particular image list, zero of shape, that is the shape of each and every image, the shape is 256 by 256, that is the horizontal number of pixels are 256, vertical number of pixels are 256. Each pixel contains three components, that is red, green and blue component over here, because each of those particular images are colored one here. Now we will divide our data set into train, validate and test set. For that reason, I am going to use train test split function from sklearn. It will take four parameters over here. The first parameter is the image list, the second parameter is the associated labels, third one is the percentage of test size here. In this case it is 0.2, means 20% will go into testing, remaining 80% will go into training here. The last parameter is random state, which is equivalent to 10. This is set to make sure that every time we will get the same result here. If you want to set with a different number, yes, you can do it. Now this train test split will give you the different things here, that is X train, X test. Associated labels will be present in Y train and Y test over here. As said earlier, we need to normalize the data in the range of 0 to 255. So that's the reason I will divide this particular X train and X test by 255 over here. And then we will reshape this particular X train and X test to four dimensional cases. The first dimension is -1 because we are not going to consider it. 256 by 256 and 3 for the three colors over here. The same thing is done for X test also. Now one more very important thing we need to perform, that is called as one hot encoding. Because unless and until we perform one hot encoding, the three labels are there which have been given 0, 1 and 2. So 2 will outperform the 0 and 1 in this particular case. That otherwise you can say that 2 will dominate on 0 and 1 label over here. To avoid that particular thing, we use something called as one hot encoding. To perform one hot encoding, we need to use the function called as two categorical y train. Second time I am using two categorical y test over here. So we will get something called as one hot encoding version of target in this particular case. Now we will try to build the model here, and then we will try to compile it. Finally, we will try to fit that particular model using training data over here. So CNN model I am going to build in this particular case. So first we will use model is equivalent to sequential. In this case I am going to use multiple number of layers for this particular model. So model dot add, I am using the two dimensional convolutional layer here. The 32 is the filter size, and then 3 by 3 I am using over here. And then the padding will be same. Input shape is 256 by 256 by 3 and activation is equivalent to ReLU. Now how we got this particular input shape is, it is coming from here. You can notice here we have reshaped our X train and X test to minus 1, 256, 256 by 3. So this one I have to take, that is 256 by 256 by 3 over here. Now once you do this particular thing, we need to add something called as max pooling. Two dimensional in this case. Again the pool size is equivalent to 3 by 3 over here. Again I am adding one more layer, that is called as convolutional 2D with 16 layers, 3 by 3, padding is same, activation is again ReLU here. In this case input shape is not required. Input shape is required only for the first layer. It is not required for the in between layers over here. Again I have added one more layer, that is called as max pooling here with pool size 2 by 2. And then I have added something called as flatten layer. And then I have added two dense layer over here. The first dense layer contains 8 as the output neurons. And the last dense layer contains 3. Because we need to get the output for three diseases here. So that's the reason we have three here. If you have binary classification, in that case we need to use only one over here. Now at the final layer, I'm using the activation function as softmax in this particular case, because it's a categorical classification in this case. And then I will print the summary of this particular model over here. So once you print this particular summary, you will get this particular result. And you can see here we have 231,347 trainable parameters over here. For this particular model, we have so many number of trainable parameters. If you want to change this particular model, yes, you can do it. If you want to add few more convolution 2D layers, yes, you can add. If you want to remove some of those particular layers, you can remove that particular thing. And if you want to change this particular pool size and all, you can play with those particular things so that you will be able to get better results in this particular case. So that you need to try and test, unless and until you will get sufficient amount of what you can say that the results over here. Now, once you create this particular model, the next step is to compile that particular model with the help of compile. Because we are using classification here, so the loss in this particular case will be categorical cross entropy. Optimizer I'm using is Adam, with learning parameter is equal to 0.0001 over here. The matrix I'm going to use is accuracy for analyzing the performance of this particular model over here. Now, once you compile this particular model, before we fit this particular model, we need another set over here. The training set will be divided into training and validation set. The main data is divided into training and testing. The within this training, we will divide that thing into training and validation over here. So that's the reason, again, I'm using train test split over here. X train and Y train will be the input for this particular thing. 20% of training data will go into testing. That is nothing but, you can say that, validation size. The remaining 80% will remain as a test training over here. And again, random state is set to 10 here. So if you look at this particular thing, total, if you assume that 100 images are there, first 80 images will go for training and 20 images will go for testing here. Within this particular 80, the 80% will go for training, and this particular remaining 20% will go for what you can say that, the validation over here. Now, once you've done this particular thing, we need to train our model. For training our model, I have set the epoch size is equivalent to 50 and the batch size is equivalent to 128. Again, you can play with this particular hyperparameter so that you will get the better accuracy at the later stage. Model.fit will accept all these particular parameters, that is X train, Y train, batch size, number of epochs, and then the validation data, X validation and Y validation over here. As said earlier, you can change the number of epochs, batch size, as well as the validation size and everything, unless and until you get the expected accuracy over here. Now you can see here, it is running for 50 number of times. Every time you can get some loss over here, and then the accuracy, the validation loss, as well as the validation accuracy over here. After 50 epochs, we are getting the loss as 0.0179. and the accuracy is equivalent to 99.83 over here. Now we will try to save this particular model, because we are getting sufficient number of, or amount of, you can say that, accuracy here. That is 99.83 is more than enough in this case. Still, if you are not happy, you can modify those particular hyperparameters so that you will get the better accuracy over here. Now we will save this particular model in this particular model folder with the name plant_disease_model.h5 over here. Once you save this particular model in this particular folder, you can notice here, this is the folder name, and within this particular folder, it will be saved over here. Now we need to draw this particular validation as well as the accuracy over here. So for that reason, again, I'm using this particular matplotlib. On X label, I have written this particular epochs. On Y label, I am writing this particular accuracy. So there are two accuracies I am drawing. One is something called as normal accuracy, another one is called as validation accuracy. This is training accuracy and validation accuracy, you can see here. Okay, and initially the training accuracy and validation accuracy increases a bit. Around at fifth epoch, we get around 67 to 70% of accuracy. When it comes to 10th epoch onwards, the accuracy will go beyond 90% over here. As and when the number of epochs increases around 20 onwards, we will get the stable accuracy for both the training as well as the validation. Over here it is around you can say that 99% over here. Now, because we are happy with this particular accuracy, we need to go with something called as making the predictions on the testing data. Before that, we will display what is the model accuracy on the testing data over here. So because we have to make sure that it will work better on this particular testing data also. So that's the reason I have printed the accuracy on the testing data, which is equivalent to 98.88%. That is far more than enough over here. Now we will make the predictions, and then we will display those particular predictions at the later stage. To make the predictions on the testing data, we will use something called as a predict function. The model.predict xtest over here. The predictions are saved into something called as y_predict over here. Now we will try to visualize the original as well as the predicted labels. For that reason, I have taken one random image, that is 11th image, that I have displayed here, and its actual label as well as the predicted label is displayed here. The actual label is a tomato bacterial spot, and the predicted label is also same over here. Because we got three probabilities over here. If you look at these particular three probabilities, 6.2 into e raised to minus 7, 5.2 into e raised to minus 5, 9.9 into e raised to minus 1. So this will be more here. So that's the reason this will be classified into third one, that is something called as tomato over here. Now coming back to the next part, where I am going to select the 50 testing images, and then I want to display original label as well as the predicted label over here. That is, y test is the original label and y predict is the predicted label over here. If you look at this particular thing, almost everything is classified correctly, because the model is working 98.88% correctly over here. So maybe one or two images may have not been classified correctly in this particular case over here. In this video, I have discussed the implementation part of plant leaf disease prediction project. The link for this particular source code is given in the description below. In the next video, I will discuss how to deploy this particular project using a Streamlit application. I hope the implementation part is clear. If you like the video, do like and share with your friends. Press the subscribe button for more videos. Press the bell icon for regular updates. Thank you for watching.